Assalamualaikum. Greetings and welcome to the Munir Muhammad Show. I'm your host, Jamil Muhammad. Brothers and sisters, we are streaming live. And if you'd like to participate in today's conversation, you can give us a call at 773-434-6625. Brothers and sisters, we have a very important show for you today. But before I introduce our guest, I'd like to remind you to please follow us on our social media platforms, which include Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. And please go to our YouTube page, click the like and the subscribe button so you can be notified whenever we post a show. Brothers and sisters, I am so excited to have live with me in studio today three outstanding guests. And for joining us today, first of all, we'll begin with our sister who is working to restore the former home of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad, our sister from Sajda's house, Sister Sajda Wendy Muhammad. Assalamu alaikum, sister.
Wa alaikum salam, sir.
Yes. And thank you for being with us today.
Thank you for having me.
And also joining us live from Atlanta, Georgia, our brother and sister, brother Anthony D. Muhammad and Sister Karima Muhammad, representing Magnolia Crescent Orchards. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam, sir.
Thank you all for being here as well.
Thank you,
brother.
And of course, it's always great to be on the show with believers, of course. And we're working on behalf of our people, so continue success in that as well. But let me begin by, first off, with you, Sister Sajda.
Yes, sir.
Please, for those in our viewing audience who may not be familiar with the work that you're doing, just give them an overview of what your latest endeavor is.
Yes, sir. And you refer to the house as Sajda House. And yes, you know, when you first came to visit, mm-hmm, and when I came here on the show, we were officially and affectionately calling it Sajda House. Because honestly, I was afraid to put the messenger's name,
yes,
on,
ma'am,
it, because it's such a huge undertaking.
Yes.
We had a house full of raccoons, as I mentioned before, and I didn't know if it would be worthy of his name. And as we started to lay out the plan, I realized, you know, that by Allah's grace, we can do this and we can call it the Honorable Elijah Muhammad House. Mm-hmm. And then most recently, since I've been here, we were are now listed on the National Registry of Historic Places as, mm-hmm, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad House.
All praises due to Allah. It's a wonderful accomplishment.
Praise be to Allah.
Yes, ma'am.
So what that is, it's the renovation and restoration of his home mm-hmm, at 4847 South Woodlawn Avenue. You hear that famous address everywhere. Mm-hmm. And so what we're doing is painstakingly and by hand restoring and renovating. And I say that way because it's not a gut rehab.
Right.
It's not a fix and flip. We are restoring it. It is a house museum here in our great city of Chicago. Mm-hmm. And we're going to use it to tell his story.
Yes.
And allow people to visit and learn about the man, about what he stands for, about what he accomplished, and what his goals currently are.
Yes, ma'am. Well said, sister. And we couldn't agree more, of course, here at CROW, the Coalition for the Remembrance of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad. You know, our works to preserve the name,
yes,
accomplishments, and teachings of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad. And it's so important because the messenger effective, by any means, are really writing them out of history.
Mm-hmm.
You know, people are fully aware of his students and their works, and also others who've taken bits and pieces, mm-hmm, of his teachings, and many of our people do not know that they originated with the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad. And so hopefully your work is another way for people to become familiar and,
yes,
or become reacquainted with,
yes,
the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad and his works. And sister, brother and sister, of course, you all are here visiting, but you've been on the show before, and I want you to talk about Magnolia Crescent, Magnolia Crescent Orchards. I always get to mix up. But also, the reason that you are here on this trip, because I understand yesterday there was a wonderful event that took place. Mm-hmm. Well, on Friday, I'm sorry. But go ahead, I want to turn it over to you.
Well, thank you again, Brother Jamil, for having us on. Sister Saza interviewed us a few months back on her Instagram Live, so now it's actually being done live on YouTube. She was introducing Magnolia Crescent Orchards to her audience. And we had such a wonderful conversation. And during the conversation, the idea was developed that we could work together to do something. We were doing what are known as cake and sips with Sister April Muhammad of Magic City Flavors in Birmingham, Alabama. And so we thought about bringing that to Chicago. And then the idea started to take further shape. And we decided that we should work together to do a fundraising event for the home of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. And so then it became a donate and sip. And so we felt that it was a perfect opportunity for us to align ourselves to this wonderful and important mission, really, that Sister Saza has embarked upon. And we wanted to provide a festive environment, but, you know, in a wonderful way, really take serious the task of doing our part as a community to bring to light this effort of fully restoring the former home of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad and to involve the community. Yes. Because Sister Saza, as we were talking off air, has done so much. I mean, sweat equity does not even begin to describe the amount of effort that this sister has poured in. Yes. And so for her to allow us, because that's how we look at it, right. It was really a blessed opportunity to be allowed to come beside her and to attempt to do our part to help bring light to this issue and to also do what we can to help make this fundraising event a festive occasion.
That's right. Yes, sir. Sister, I want to say this because our viewing audience, they know about the work, they hit a title, but as Brother Anthony alluded to, there was a lot of equity and work that was gone into this, whether it was dealing with the city with zoning issues and just the contractors and just, and then seeking approval. I mean, because it's not something you just automatically do. So talk about what inspired you to take on this endeavor.
Excellent question.
Man, you know, it's like Allah prepared me for this and just sat it in my lap and said, this is your next assignment. And of course, I fell in love with the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad through my love for the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. And being one of his followers and working for him many years ago and for many years, I just fell in love with him. And so when I learned that the house was for sale, and I knew that there were other efforts to get the house, I was like, oh, all praise is due to Allah. And then it looked like those efforts fell through. And it started being on different auction sites and foreclosure sites. And just one particular day when I was in my office, and I was actually living in Maryland at the time, the house just popped up. And I have these pop-up alerts because I'm a real estate developer. Yes, yes. And I looked at the address, Brother Jamil, and I said, 4847. South Woodlawn. So then began the race to save it, to get it quickly. We were unable to get a loan on it, so I had to go into my own personal savings to secure the home. And then just continuing to move forward. We had opposition very early on in the process. We overcame that. And now it's just a matter of allowing Allah to let me know how he wants us to present his messenger to the world. And so the idea is to replicate parts of the house to the way it looked when the messenger actually lived there. And then to restore it at a standard that is worthy of who he is. So to be a part now, to be listed now on the National Historic Registry and to deploy those levels of the higher levels and exquisite levels of renovation and restoration is just the tip of the iceberg of how we want to present this beautiful and amazing man to the world.
Well said. Sister Kareem, I want to go back because we did introduce Magnolia Crescent Orchards and we talked about the donated sip, but we didn't say that it was a non-alcoholic winery, and I want to make sure we give proper context the winery. So talk about the actual business itself, sister.
Okay, well, as you just stated, we actually offer 100% non-alcoholic wines, sparkling teas, and spirit alternatives.
Yes, ma'am.
And so we believe in promoting what we call sober sophistication. And that's basically sharing with the world that there are alternatives out there. Yes. You don't have to engage in alcohol to have a good time.
That's right.
It doesn't have to be a part of our adulting experience. And so we were blessed to be able to curate some of the finest non-alcoholic wines from places like Italy and France. Matter of fact, we have a new one since the last time we were here that's from Singapore.
Okay.
Mm. And so we're just going to continue to offer those to the community.
Yes, well said. I wanted to do that because I know, you know, out there in the public, you know, they get to type in and talk.
Talking about it, start trending.
Got to do that. And sister, you know, I'll talk about how the fundraiser this past Friday came together, you know, in the reception now that you received from the people there.
Mm-hmm. Yes, the response to this effort has been overwhelmingly positive. It's a celebratory type of effort from people like our mayor, mm-hmm. to many congressmen, mm-hmm. to people in all walks of life, people who look like us and people who don't. Mm-hmm. We've been very blessed and very fortunate to enjoy that support. People who want to put in some elbow grease, donate some money. Mm-hmm. And so as part of the Black Muslim Business Directory, as Brother Anthony mentioned, mm-hmm. I interviewed them, and I said, I'm always about trying to create this unity and this ecosystem, mm-hmm. that I believe that the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad wanted for us to really be able to go for ourselves, depend on one another, establish our culture together, and really just kind of show forth another level of civilization. And so we talked about their cake and sip events, and then we had a follow-up call, and we said, aha, donate and sip.
Yes.
And so we decided to donate and sip. Another great friend of mine is Eric Williams from the Silver Room on 53rd Street.
That's right.
Eric said, I believe in this ecosystem. You all can have it here. And so it's just a way for everybody to bring their own social circles together. We had a great turnout. We were excited. We did meet our financial goals, mm-hmm. so we want to make sure I'm looking straight into the camera to let people know. Go to SajidaHouseDonations.com and make sure you donate. We're about a little over 80% done with the house. And so for this final, little less than 20%, I'm going to the public to collect donations, especially from our people, and just show forth that unity.
Yes, ma'am.
And just show the people that when we come together, we can do something magnificent like this.
You know, I believe that it's outstanding that you're able to collaborate, of course, even with Eric Williams and donating.
Yes.
I also want to send a shout out to our brother Yahya Muhammad.
Yes.
And Sean Michelle Ice Cream. I know you had one there before.
Did you get you some Sajda ice cream?
No, I didn't.
It's a bean pie infused ice cream.
You know what? But it's only on certain occasions, right? It's a specialty?
No, you can get it there all the time now.
All right.
And all the proceeds go towards, or some of the proceeds go towards Sajda House.
I will make sure I do that
yes.
this week. But it's also key to highlight the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad taught us to pool our resources.
Yes. Absolutely. Yes.
And to collectively help and support one another. You mean all of us benefit from
yes.
that, you know. And
yes,
so
that's right.
I think it's so important because in our viewing audience, you may not realize the opposition that we receive whenever we mention the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad's name. And I understand that many of you may think that you know him, but you don't know the depths of his teachings.
Yes.
When we say life-giving teachings and life-changing teachings, that is exactly what it is.
That's
and
right.
So whenever you see the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad's name, it gives pause to certain people.
Mm-hmm.
And so whenever you're doing something to try to raise awareness mm-hmm. and highlight it, you're going to have to go that extra mile.
Gotta go.
But one of the things that you said, and I want to build on, is that The Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad taught us that we would have friendship in all walks of life.
That's right.
And so we have people who are Muslims, non-Muslims, they come from different ethnicities, mm-hmm. who understand the value and importance of what he did. And restoring this house in Chicago, of course we lived here, but you know, the foundation in many ways of things. I know that Detroit is, you know, temple number one.
Yeah.
However, Chicago is so key and important. And even here, there are many of our younger people who may not be familiar with them. And
that's
so
true.
What do you hope to achieve, mm-hmm. by restoring the house and making it into this historical place where people could come, mm-hmm. and view and learn about the messenger?
You know, I would be remiss if I didn't say to you that this piece of property is the single most important piece of property in modern day black history.
That's right.
Because more leaders and influencers from our community met and dined in that property, mm-hmm. than any other place in the world. Because they all came there to meet and collaborate and convene with the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad. And the list is long. And if we start listing, we couldn't exhaust the number of people that were there.
Yeah.
And so it's important for people to understand that history. The other thing that I want to accomplish, Brother Jamil, is that I want the real story. I want the real man. I want people to know who and what he truly is. We do hear about the students. But the question is, what did he put in those students? And how he so graciously sort of stepped to the back. And now, because he was so quiet, and because oftentimes the students are much more colorful than he is, some of his history starts to get written out of mm-hmm. history.
And that's why I want to commend you all in particular. You know, it's one thing, the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, who's a national representative, the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad in the Nation of Islam, wonderful in his work.
Yes.
And many times we become enamored with the person in front of us.
Yes.
But the messenger taught us to go to that root knowledge.
Right.
And Minister Farrakhan consistently tells people to look at the teacher.
That's right.
But for you to be able to do that and recognize the works of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad, I want to commend you on that, because all of us aren't able to do that.
Yes.
Yes.
Sometimes we get stuck with who's in front.
That's right.
You mentioned the people that the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad entertained at the home. One of the pictures of Dr. Martin Luther King that's in the studio now, people talk about it all the time.
Yes.
They don't publicize that Martin Luther King met with the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad. And we believe when you trace the timeline, his message began to change,
yes.
as the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad, mm-hmm. taught him.
Yes.
And so many things that people get out of different books and things that weren't done to give the true picture of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad. And so that's why it is so very important that we take ownership and begin to tell the story.
Yes. That's exactly right.
And Brother Anthony, I know that you're originally from Chicago.
That's right.
Brother, coming up. And so what is it like for you? I know that you've been away for a while, but to come back as a member of the Nation of Islam,
yes.
and see what our sister's doing.
Well, I love to share this history that Sister Sizden and I have, because when I first became a registered Muslim, on the west side of Chicago, in Muhammad Mosque number 2B, is around April and May of 1997. Sister Sazda, as we referred to her then, Sister Wendy, was standing right there. And so I did not have any clue at that time. And it took years later, I should say, through listening to interviews that she had done, to find out just how phenomenally talented and gifted of a sister she is.
Yeah.
And so to be able to come home, it allows me to see Chicago through a new lens.
Yes, sir.
And, you know, I'm so thankful, because for a while because I've been in Georgia now for going on 22 years, and I used to think about maybe it would be a good time to go back, you know. And after a while, it just seemed kind of romantic, a romantic notion to go back home where family and friends are. But now I feel like I've been reinvigorated and have a purpose with coming back home. Socializing with family and friends, that's fun. You know, that's good. And it has some importance to it. But nothing is more important than to bring whatever Allah has blessed and poured into me throughout these years that I've been away from Chicago back to this type of an endeavor. And you brought up a point, Brother Jamil, about the pictures. And one thing I was sharing with Karima yesterday, you know, it's interesting how we see a lot of our artists who make these depictions of great political figures, I'll say it like that, who, and they draw up these scenarios of them having these meetings with Nelson Mandela, a lot of our luminaries, and as to somehow suggest that that has had an impact on what they do. But here you have a real live man who met with God. Jeez. He came up from a neighborhood called Deep Step, Georgia. And then he went to Black Bottom, Detroit. And he was a man of himself who said he was so far in the mud that he could only see his eyeballs. And our young people talk nowadays about getting it out the mud. So here's a man who literally of himself said he came up and God pulled him up out of the mud to sit to a point now where you have world leaders, people who are of great influence to come through that home. So, you know, it's important for us to not fantasize about meeting with Black great leaders, but to really do the history and see the impact. And like you were saying, the timeline with Dr. King, if you go back and study this type of legislation and things that Thurgood Marshall took, Sister Wilma Rudolph, Kwame Ture, and you start to trace, when did they meet with the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad at this home? And what was the impact that they had when they left this great man? It's important for us. So be able to do anything to try to help bring light to this, it's a tremendous honor, Brother Jamil.
You know, brother, and I'm so glad that you told that, alluded to the early beginnings of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad, realizing that a man with a third grade education who, you know, didn't have much, but based on a word, because remember, after that 3.5 years, Master Farad Muhammad, who we know to be God in person, withdrew. And the messenger went on with that word.
That's right.
And created a nation within a nation.
Yes.
In a time, not that it's not open season on Black people now,
yeah,
but back then, it was even worse.
Yes.
And so to create that nation, to have the schools, to have the infrastructure as far as transportation, import, exporting, all of the things that we needed to have it then, if God wasn't blessing them, then who was? And so that's really the premise, because too often in our communities, leaders are made and branded based on restating the problem with the Black community.
Good point.
However, when we talk about measuring the results.
Yes.
The Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad, they don't even put him in the picture because he had results.
Absolutely.
And you know, and so we're hoping through our collective efforts and representation of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad that our people begin to take a second, a first, second, or third look
at him.
Not just to remember him, but to be inspired to change our condition now. And so, sister, when you talk about working with the legislation and all these people pooling their resources to help with this, they remember the works of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad. And if they don't, they recognize your work and your example, and they're inspired by that. So that's what I want to make sure that we convey to our viewing audience is that this is a work program.
Yes.
And this restoration, this example, is all for the purpose of inspiring our people to make a change.
Absolutely. Yes. Inspiring our people to make a change, showing us a new way of life, a new way of thinking, a new way of being, a new way of looking at ourselves. See, because Brother Jamil, our history happens on everyday blocks and everyday neighborhoods and everyday communities. And when many of our people migrated to the north during that period of the Great Migration, about 1920, about 1972, many of them became influencers and were icons and inventors. And they changed the entire landscape of the world while migrating to these redlined areas in major cities around the United States of America. Then gentrification happened. And then in all these cities, they brought highway projects right through our neighborhoods. Right. So the homes, the history is all but forgotten. And if we're not careful, and if we don't really focus on urban historic preservation, then we will find our history from that period being extinct. Because I've learned so much about so many different people. So what we want to do is be the vanguard,
yes,
of that urban historic preservation, and having people step up and say, what did your parents do? Who was this influencer? Mm-hmm. And let's pull together with our collective efforts.
Beautiful.
And our upliftment of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad, and show the world that this is a man who not only fought for independent education,
yes,
along him and his believers, and died for it.
That's right.
The rights of women,
yes,
despite, mm-hmm, of all of what they say about him. I'm so sick of the same stories over and over again.
That's right.
This is a man who lived a long and fruitful life. You can't think of anything else to say?
No.
That piece of it. Mm-hmm. He was collectively responsible for us calling ourselves brothers and sisters.
That's right.
Nobody was saying that.
They weren't even saying black.
They weren't even saying black. Then James Brown, who was at the house,
yes,
came and said, I'm black and I'm proud.
That's right.
So he was influencing people. There, I've met people who said, I learned real estate from the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad. I was inspired to be a doctor through my meeting with the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad. He inspired research into melanin.
That's right.
And the origin of black people and the origin of Caucasian.
Jesus.
He inspired all of that.
Jesus.
So the entire landscape that we stand on as a country today, we owe the Most Honorable Elijah,
yes,
Muhammad.
That's right.
Yes.
People around the world, everybody wants to look and be like you and I.
Yes.
Hip hop is born out of the pride that the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad gave us as a people.
Come on.
And everybody around the world eats off of that $1 billion industry to this day.
Come on, sister.
So we want to show the world the influence of this beautiful man.
You know, you articulated that so well.
Absolutely.
And,
yes,
you know, when we look at, now we know these things.
Yes, sir.
But every day, science testifies,
yes,
to the truth that the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad taught 40, 50, 60
That's
years
right.
ago.
Mm-hmm.
When you look at, now there's no dispute about Caucasian people, mm-hmm, only being here 6,000 years.
Mm-hmm.
There's evidence of the deportation of the moon.
Come on now.
Mm-hmm.
When you talk about how to eat to live, everybody's taking bits and pieces off that tree.
Intermittent fasting is the thing now, right? Mm-hmm.
And so when you look at even Yaqub in the grafting process, mm-hmm, all of those things that the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad did not get credit for, he still doesn't get credit for,
yeah,
but it's testified and it's been proven today.
Yes.
And so with that said, brothers and sisters, I want you to just rest on that point while we take a quick break and come back with more with our beautiful guests. We'll be right back.
You are watching The Muneer Muhammad Show, a production of CROW. Please take time to join us at CROW, the Coalition for the Remembrance of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. CROW is the National Archive of the Nation of Islam and houses one of the largest collections of historical audio, video, and print documentation on the total black experience. CROW is located at 2435 West 71st Street, the corner of 71st and CROW Lane. We are open 7 days a week, 9 to 5. Our number, 773-925-1600. We look forward to seeing you at CROW.
It's against your own health
that how creates more diseases in your body than you have any dreams of. In fact, about it, stop eating the hog, eat right, eat the proper food, and you will find 75% of your sickness leaving you. Yes, try it.
Knowledge is power. To discover sources of power and knowledge, join us in reading two books from the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, Birth of a Savior and The True History of Jesus. The Birth of a Savior details the birth of this God, his name and his purpose, what he would do and how he would do it. The True History of Jesus, as taught by the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, outlines the true story of Mary, Joseph, and Jesus. These two books and more of the plain truth, as taught by the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, are waiting for you at CROW, the Coalition for the Remembrance of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, 2435 West 71st Street, open 7 days a week. We encourage you to take the time to visit us and learn more about the Honorable Elijah Muhammad's teachings. We hope to see you soon.
Assalamu alaikum, brothers and sisters. We are back continuing our conversation with our sister Sajda Wendy Muhammad and our brother Anthony D and sister Karima Muhammad. And sister, we were talking about the influence of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad in the validation of his teachings. And I know that you had some additional thoughts on some of the influence.
Well, the impact, the reach of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad is not just exclusive to America. It's not just exclusive to Black Americans or Black Muslim Americans. Mm-hmm. I mean, we're talking about a reach that has impacted the works of Dr. Cress Welsing, the ISIS papers, Dr. Naeem Akbar, who really introduced the concept of Black psychology. That came from the teachings of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad. Right. When we look at internationally, Sheikh Anta Diop from Senegal, much of his research in terms of the origins, as you mentioned earlier, of Blacks being the indigenous, being the original Black man and woman of the world, the Asiatic Black man, that research came from the teachings of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad. When we look at Dr. Ivan Van Sertima, and he talks about the connection between what we now know as Mexico and the continent of Africa, all of this came from the things that they learned when they came to the mosque, many of them, from the teachings of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad. And the list goes on. Brother Cesar Chavez, who was instrumental as it relates to the farmers, the farmer work labor union, sat with the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad on numerous occasions, according to historical books. So it's not just a history that needs to be preserved exclusively for us, but this is something that is really a global responsibility to preserve the name and the integrity in terms of the impact and the contributions that he makes to the world.
Yeah.
You know, you mentioned in terms of intermittent fasting, sister did. You know, that's a hot thing now. Everybody wants an intermittent fast, but that's in How to Eat to Live.
That's right.
Yes, right.
You know, these are books that came from the mind of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad based upon what he was taught by Master Farhad Muhammad. And this cutoff that my husband mentioned a little bit earlier, this cutoff of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad from his students, mm-hmm. is intentional.
Yes, ma'am.
It's intentional. It's so that we will never go back to see who the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad is and who Master Fadat Muhammad is. We will never look to see what our connection is to the teachings and to Islam and to the originator of the heavens and the earth. We will always be looking at Caucasians as being our gods. Mm-hmm. Caucasians being the ones that gives us civility. Caucasians mm-hmm. giving us the things that help us to maintain life and to be expansive in life, when that couldn't be further from the truth.
Yeah, you know, and I'm glad you brought up more of an international mm-hmm. perspective, because this falsehood that the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad was not received and respected by the Orthodox Muslims is complete falsehood.
Absolutely.
You know, the Most Honorable Elijah offered to build him a house if he would teach the people there. I'm sorry, kingdom. I won't say a house itself, but you know, the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad was well received internationally. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, so many people tried to minimize what he did or discredit him, but it has not been duplicated.
Yes. That's right.
And so those who've had the most success have been the ones who've been most careful in their duty.
That's
and
right.
that's why we have to, no matter what you think of the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, you have to acknowledge that God has blessed him.
That's right.
Absolutely.
And that many people have been introduced to the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad because of his works and his messages.
Yes.
And so
that's right.
That's why I say that, you know, regardless of your connection to the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad, if you can make that connection,
yes,
that's the blessing in itself.
Yes.
You know.
Yes. Mm-hmm. It's so important, Brother Jamil, that we do not allow his name and his works to be written out of history.
Yes.
Supporting this project is very important because, like I said, this project is the vanguard mm-hmm. for urban historic preservation.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Everyday blocks, everyday neighborhoods, everyday homes. This is where our history takes place. And so we are dedicated to making sure that we also help others.
Yes.
Create house museums in Chicago and Cleveland and New York or wherever. Mm-hmm. Because through the I'm a founding member of the Coalition of Black House Museums, and that is one of our goals because it's so important. And so this particular house being the single most important house in Black history, and that's not an opinion, that's a fact.
Yes, mm-hmm.
Because if you visit Crow, you can see all the photos and all the people. They've been showing B-roll of all the people who have been in this home.
Right.
So supporting this is supporting yourself.
And I want you, you are a real estate developer.
Right? Yes, sir.
Talk about the importance of that, because the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad always taught us to get land. Mm-hmm. But when you talk particularly about urban areas where we have been ciphered off and sectioned off, redlined, everything you can, whenever there's progress, it means that they're moving us out.
Mm-hmm.
And so from your expertise standpoint, just talk about how important land is, and at least, and if you can't acquire it, at least hold your elected officials or somebody accountable for making sure that you have access to resources.
You know, there's so many of our cities that are blighted.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And I did a show on called Who Will Save Our Cities. There's so many cities now where you can buy land at a discounted price. You can buy houses at a discounted price. Don't sell grandmama's house. Keep her home.
Yes.
Pull your resources together as a family and figure out how to keep, because this is how we're going to build our community.
Yes.
This is how we're going to preserve our history.
Yes, ma'am.
Because if we get rid of grandmama's house, mm-hmm. then what about what she did? She probably was the first Black something.
That's yes.
Right. But we forget about that. Mm-hmm. And so the idea is go into these cities and buy up these properties. Fix them up. Mm-hmm. If you don't want to move back in there, maybe it's too small, maybe you're a little too, mm-hmm. you know,
yes.
big at that point, mm-hmm. but rent it out.
That's right.
Provide good homes for mm-hmm. our people.
Yes.
And see, this will change the tax records, and it'll begin to change the educational systems. There's so much of America right now that's for sale.
Yes.
There's schools for sale. There's warehouses for sale. There's land. There's homes, there's properties, there's grocery stores. Let's pool our resources together and go and get some of these properties in our urban areas.
That's right. Well, praises due to Allah. It's so important. I want to shift just a little bit because we do have here, you know, as far as some of your non-alcoholic beverages here. And I wanted to highlight that because I love the term, and I told you this before, I love the sober sophistication.
Yes. Yes.
And I love the adulting. Right. Because so many people think, Muslims, we have fun, we enjoy Absolutely. One another's company, and we can do things in a righteous manner.
That's Absolutely. Right.
And so that's why I want to make sure that we take some time to speak about some of your products and, you know, just the history of it. Because before, you know, you gave a lesson. And so I know many people out there, I don't want them to underestimate the value in what you do and what you bring to the table.
Mm-hmm. Praise be to Allah. Mm-hmm. Well, there are two types of non-alcoholic wines that we offer. Mm-hmm. Ones that have been fermented and those that have never undergone fermentation. Of course, the fermentation process is basically taking the grapes that have been crushed. Mm-hmm. They add yeast, which helps to quicken the process of fermentation. It breaks down, and the byproduct is what we know as alcohol. Right. So with these products, we either have those who have gone through that process completely and it have been de-alkalized, because much of the technology that maybe 10, 15 years mm-hmm. ago mm-hmm. didn't exist, mm-hmm. it does now.
Yeah.
And so now they're able to bring the alcohol level down to 0.0,
okay.
right? Now, then we have some that have never undergone fermentation. So they basically take it and stop the fermentation process before it has an opportunity to begin. So let's say, hypothetically, I were to make a fresh squeezed orange juice mm-hmm. for Sister Sajda, and she set it on her counter for 6 hours. In 6 hours, because there's natural yeast in the air, it would actually begin the process of fermenting.
Right.
So to stop it, they actually heat it up to about 104 degrees and stop it before that process of breaking down actually happens. And so that's how these products are generated. Now, one thing I would share, this is gonna be different from what we typically find at a local package store.
Yes.
Because the non-alcoholic wines, many of them, they read non-alcoholic, but they have between 0.5 and 0.9% alcohol. Why? Because in this country, there's a threshold. It's kind of like with organic food.
Yeah.
If you can have 30% use of pesticides and herbicides and all this kind of stuff, right. and still call it organic.
Yes, ma'am.
It's the same thing with non-alcoholic products. And so, but that's why it's important to really look on the back of your bottle and see what the alcohol content is. We have made a promise, a guarantee to all of our clients that you will never find anything that is not 100% alcohol free on our website. That is a promise, that is a part of our mission, because we don't drink and we don't want to introduce alcohol to any of our clients under any circumstances.
That's right.
So even as we move into developing our own product, that will still be number one on our mission.
Yes, and I wanted you to say that because, again, I love to hear the science behind something, you know, and I think that's so important because most of us come from a consumer perspective anyway.
Yes.
And we just, you know, we see it and we just get it. And so I thank you for breaking that down. But I want you to also talk about, I know that you have the property there at the orchard, but there's expansion, there's growth. And so you're going to be, your endeavor is to do more than
Absolutely.
Just sell non-alcoholic wine. And I want you to talk about that as well.
Yes. Yeah, so thank you, Brother Jabil, because Magnolia Crescent Orchards, you know, I like to also emphasize the orchard aspect of it. And so we have 2.3 acres of land that we acquired in a city called Chattahoochee Hills, which is just about 20 minutes west of Atlanta. And in a short period of time, we've planted over 88 different fruit trees and fruit shrubs. We have, well, now we have 12 egg-laying hens. And since the last time we talked, Brother Jamil, we actually have two beehives. And so we use the beehives for their pollinating power. They will help develop our fruit shrubs and fruit trees a lot quicker. And we also want to have the honey and also the bee pollen because it has medicinal properties as well. And so we open this space up not only for people to come as a place where they can get fruit eventually, because we definitely want to make it to be what they call a U-pick. Right. This is where people can come on your property and pick fruit and berries and stuff themselves. Right. But we also open it up as a retreat space of people who want to come and do yoga, people who want to do what's called grounding, where they can take their shoes off and let their feet touch the earth, which has tremendous healing power.
Yes.
And also, we open it as a space for people who want to showcase their special moments in life. So if your students are graduating, which is happening a lot nowadays, or if you're engaged and you want to have these engagement photos, or even if you want to have a small micro wedding, you can come to Magnolia Crescent Orchards in our property. We're still developing it, but hopefully by the end of the summer, we'll have it available to host all of these type of services on our property.
And I wanted to say that you are married, a married couple.
Yes.
And you didn't grow up on a winery or a farm.
No, sir.
This is something that originated from, I think it was a family trip, wasn't it?
Well, we took a, I love to tell the story, but it was a Sunday afternoon, and I'm trying to do some binging on Netflix. I'm just going to be honest with you all. And this black woman here, she disturbed my peace, y'all. And so she was like, look, let's go to North Georgia. And I'm knowing when she says North Georgia, that's a 2-hour drive one way. But we went, and I was happy we went, and we went and visited a winery. And it was beautiful. We met the owner. He took us on ATVs around the property, and he showed us some of the infrastructure of how he grows his grapes and how he protects it. And we had a wonderful time. The only drawback, Brother Jamil, is that when it came for our children who wanted like a fruit slushie, the only thing they had was that which had alcohol in it. That was the only thing. And so that was really the impetus for us to think, how could we create that same kind of experience that we had and share it, but remove the alcohol from the experience? So that was really the birth of us. And that was even before we actually acquired the land. So having that idea and having that thought in mind preceded us actually acquiring the property.
Yeah. And it's so important for our viewers to understand that all of this requires work.
Yes.
It starts with a thought, but there's work.
Absolutely.
And so I say that because that speaks to the sacrifice and really why I encourage you to support not only Sister Sajda, but Brother Anthony and Sister Karima as well.
Yes.
Because these endeavors, my father used to call them labors of love.
Mm. Yes, absolutely.
And it's out of our love that, you know, and let's be honest, we couldn't love ourselves or our people if it were not for the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad.
That's right.
We really
fact.
Wouldn't know how.
That's
to,
right.
To
fact.
Be honest, brothers
yes.
and sisters. So,
yes.
you know, you look at that and it's the foundation and the inspiration for what we do.
Yeah.
And so this sacrifice, this effort, that's why it's so important to, whether it's donate, patronize, you know, there, however you want to say it, but to give back.
Yes.
And that's so important. And you're not only asking for it, you do it.
Yes.
You highlight and you work with other black businesses to pool our resources. And so looks like we have a caller. I'm going to go to the line.
Okay, yes, sir.
Caller, you're on the air. Go ahead with your question or comment.
Salaam alaikum.
Wa alaikum salaam, Brother Shaheed.
Brother Anthony, this is Shaheed. The last time you was here, brother, I believe you gave me one of your cards, but I must have lost it or something. But I want to ask you a question now. Do you have any of those cards on you today?
Yes, sir, brother.
Okay, well, before the meeting's over now, I'm coming over there. Give me some of them, because I might want to order some of your juice that you got up there. Because they look pretty good. Remember, I would tell you that what I drink that wealth is it, but I want to get rid of that and start drinking some of your stuff, what you make, you and your wife make. So
yeah.
I'm going to come over there when the show is over here, then I'll talk to you.
Okay.
All right. Thank you, brother.
Thank you, Brother Shaheed.
Thank you, Brother Shaheed. That's one of our co-founders, Brother Shaheed Muslim. And while I do that, I want to, Brother, just say happy anniversary to our other co-founder, Brother Khalif Muhammad, and his wife, Sister Shakira Muhammad. They celebrated 57 years of marriage yesterday. I want to make sure that I acknowledge that.
If I could just clarify something.
Yes.
We are not producing these products.
Yes, ma'am.
We do have a product that we are in the infancy stage of developing, mm-hmm. so it will honestly, right. sincerely be our own. But these are actually ones that we've curated. So we've brought them in from overseas. Mm-hmm. Other mm-hmm. producers yeah. have actually made these non-alcoholic wines.
Yes.
So I just want to clarify
yes.
that.
Yes. And he mentioned sparkling grape juice. And these are different, of course, from a sparkling grape juice.
Absolutely. Yes, sir.
You know, yeah. I would ask you to explain, sister, but I figure you might say, well, one say sparkling grape juice and one is wine. Or is there a more scientific explanation?
Honestly, I don't even know what goes into making just standard grape juice.
Okay.
All I just know about the non-alcoholic wine.
Yes.
But usually it's the difference between it being fermented and not fermented. But right. in terms of what other mm-hmm. things that they put into grape juice, I'm not sure.
Okay. As we begin to wind down the final 5 minutes or so, I really want to give equal time mm-hmm. into... and I'll start with you all, Brother Anthony and Sister Karima,
right.
of sharing your information, first of all, how people can find you,
yes.
how they can order products and support you, whether it's on social media, website, because I want you to convey them, you know, I want our people to really begin to support our own, and so I want to turn it over to you.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So our website is, pardon me, www.magnoliacrescent.farm. Again, magnoliacrescent.farm, and you can reach us at Magnolia Crescent Orchards on Instagram and Facebook, and we are developing our YouTube channel as well. So if you do a search on Magnolia Crescent Orchards, you'll find some content, but we're developing that further as we speak. And I also want to state that as Sister Saza talked about earlier, we are the byproduct of an ecosystem that has been developed for us. Magnolia Crescent Orchards, as a physical location with all the fruit shrubs and fruit trees, would not be in existence had we not benefited from an ecosystem that already exists amongst Black agriculturalists and farmers in the metro Atlanta area. And so I also want to say that we are so fortunate and thankful to Allah that He has allowed us to come this far with Sister Sazda.
Yes.
And as I communicated to her offline, just because this was an event that has come and gone, we are committed. We are fully dedicated to lock arms with her to see this completion of this project, all the financing that has to be done to complete it all the way to the finish line. And so you can make sure that Magnolia Crescent will be pushing this message of getting all of our people involved to do your part to help complete the development of the restoration of the former home of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad.
That's right.
Well said, our praises to Allah. Sister Sasha.
Brother Jamil, you know, what we're a part of, we are so blessed to be part of a new emerging market.
Yes.
And anybody who studies finance and studies business, you know how important new emerging markets is, mm-hmm. not only to investors, but to those who get in on the ground level.
Yes.
This new ecosystem, mm-hmm. that's an emerging market. This urban historic preservation, that is a new emerging market. We got in on an emerging market with just the renovation and restoration of the home, because the minister told me a story about how he was walking down the driveway with the messenger, and he pointed to a tree and he said, one day when they find out who I am, they're going to rip the bark off the trees.
That's right.
I said, well, okay, well, we're going to start ripping now.
Mm-hmm.
We're not going to throw away anything. So we literally took the copper down from the house, and instead of throwing it away and giving it away, we melted it, molded it, and created these commemorative minted coins for our fundraisers. So these are, each coin has its own registration number. It's a collector's item. This holds the energy of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad. Mm-hmm. We have these beautiful pendants that you see myself and Sister Karima wearing. Mm-hmm. This copper is made from the messenger's home. And just a few months after the messenger inspired us with that idea, mm-hmm. we found out that Goldman Sachs said copper is the new oil.
Wow.
Because now General Motors and all these people are moving towards electric cars, and they use copper and cobalt to fuel and create the batteries.
That's right.
That fuel the new cars. So what does that mean? He's always showing us, invest in this, go here. Here's a new emerging market. And I'm telling you, if you get in on this new emerging market now, join us, join this ecosystem, support the renovation and the restoration of the former home of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad. If you want this coin, just go to sajdahouse.com. That's sajdahouse.com. If you already got a coin and you don't want to buy another one and you just want to give a donation, go to sajdahousedonations.com.
Well said, sister, and I'm so proud of you. I want may Allah continue to bless both all of you in your endeavors. And I'm so glad to have you on, and I'm sure you'll be back again soon.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Brothers and sisters, I want to remind you, please, to support us at CRO, the Coalition for the Remembrance of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad. Of course, CRO TV and CRO Radio is just an extension of what we do at CRO. We preserve the name, the accomplishments, the teachings of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad, and we encourage you to support us so we can continue not only what we do from a media standpoint, but what we do is the basis of our work is preserve the teachings of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad and help our community. Please call us to take out a donation or take out a membership with us. We are a coalition with you in mind. If you want to find out more information, you can visit us at www.cro.org, www.croe.org, or right now, when this show is over, dial 773-925-1600 to find out more information about a membership or how you can make a donation. I promise you, we'll answer the phone. And on behalf of the CRO Television production team, our guests, Brother Anthony, Sister Karima, and Sister Sajda, I'm your host, Jamil Muhammad. Thank you so much for viewing. I leave you with the greetings of peace. Assalamu alaikum.